Hello, my name is Mark Valdez. Today I'll be starting with 20th century philosopher Michel Foucault, but my main emphasis will be on various surrealist artists and how their work influenced Breaking Bad and Better Call Saul. One of the most characteristic visible features of these television series is the presence of grids. Grids are absolutely everywhere. In the facades of buildings, in plaid shirts, and in various props. Their ubiquity suggests that they are not references to individual artists or artworks, but rather to a general condition. Certain kinds of grids seem to have specific meanings. For example, Cartesian grids, grids made up of squares, are flashed as props only in conjunction with questions, and the meaning appears to be, "Help me understand." Here we see glass block windows, first popularized in Chicago in the 1930s. Glass block windows appear to mean a Chicago connection of some sort. I propose that the many different kinds of grids are inspired by the legacy of Michel Foucault. Foucault's ideas about power mediated by visibility are present throughout Breaking Bad. I believe the various grids represent the epistema of Michel Foucault. For Foucault, the epistema is the unconscious ordering of the production of knowledge, including science, in society. It is like a grid that is overlaid on top of culture and defines not only what is known, but what can be known. It is a network that defines the conditions that make a controversy or problem possible. Because the grids that Peter Gould and company deal with are actual physical objects, they can go one step beyond Foucault and show us the quality of the grids too. For example, here is the feedlot where Mike and Nacho meet in episode JMM. And this is a wonderful aerial photograph of the feedlot captured by Adam Ramirez and his drone. The irregular grid formed by the broken asphalt, the summer cypress, and the tumbleweed is an absolute mess. This grid tells us that the system of knowledge that is guiding Nacho in his decision to lead the Salamancas is a shambles. There is too much that Nacho needs to know that he just doesn't. Moving on to surrealism, as I picture it, the writers of these two television series, particularly Peter Gould with his background in art, use surrealism as a source of ideas and material. Last year at this conference, I presented on the impact of Salvador Dali. Here, for example, is Dali's painting Paranoiac Visage, which helped inspire the three scenes pictured here. Dali's The Last Supper inspires set design in the Super Lab, particularly in regards to the angles of the lighting, as seen here on the right. And here is Dali's Suez, with its cross-section of an empty Suez Canal. On the right is the White family's empty backyard swimming pool after it has been taken over by skateboarders. As you can see, Dalí's influence leads directly from painting to scene. I wondered if there were surrealists other than Dalí whose works affected the television series in the same way. Here is Belgian artist René Magritte's painting called The Treachery of Images, featuring a pipe labeled "This is not a pipe." The painting exploits our habit of assuming a natural connection between text and drawing. A similar dissonance occurs when Heisenberg holds up a crystal of what appears to be meth and tells Tuco, "This is not meth." Like Tuco, we assume a connection that just isn't there. In Better Call Saul's episode Cobbler, Chuck sets a metronome to work and repeatedly plays Sicilienne up to the point where he ruins the music with false notes. What is this about? In 1923, a surrealist artist named Man Ray and an American living in Paris placed a photo of an eye on the pendulum of a metronome and set it to work watching him paint. In 1932, bitter about a failed romance, Man Ray published instructions to attach a picture of a departed lover's eye to the pendulum of a metronome, set an annoying tempo, and then destroy it with a single hammer blow. Chuck doesn't attach a picture of an eye to the metronome or destroy it, but he does destroy the musical piece, a piece that was important to Rebecca. Note that the tip of the metronome's pendulum repeatedly slashes across our view of Chuck's eye. The slashing calls to mind the eye-slashing in Un Chien Andalou, a surrealist film made by Luis Buñuel and Salvador Dalí in 1929. There was a sacrilegious book that influenced all the surrealists, Les Chants de Mal d'Or, an 1869 book by the self-styled Comte de L'Outremont. L'Outremont was the nom de plume of a French poet named Isidore de Casse, originally from Uruguay. He died young at age 24. Years after his death, surrealists stumbled across his obscure work and proclaimed it as one of their chief inspirations. Mal d'Or, the main character, is utterly reprehensible, a complete nihilist. In the center here is one idea of what Mal d'Or might look like. Reading Les Chants de Mal d'Or, I was struck by how familiar the character of Mal d'Or seemed, calling to mind Heath Ledger's interpretation of the Joker from the 2008 Batman film The Dark Knight. Ledger based his interpretation in part on a 1989 Batman graphic novel called Arkham Asylum, which was inspired in turn by surrealist visual style and the writings of the European avant-garde. Ledger's Joker and Saul Goodman are distant spiritual cousins, both descendants of Mal d'Or. In Better Call Saul's episode Winner, Jimmy makes a rousing but cynical speech to a scholarship applicant. Jimmy's speech is a rewrite of Mal d'Or's speech to a young man with changes to account for different circumstances. Mal d'Or says, "Virtuous and well-meaning methods lead nowhere. You must bring into play more powerful levers, more cunningly contrived traps. Victories do not simply happen. The end excuses the means." Jimmy says something very similar.
"You're going to do whatever it takes. Do you hear me? You are not going to play by the rules. You're going to go your own way. You're going to do what they won't do. You're going to be smart. You are going to cut corners, and you are going to win. They're on the 35th floor, you're going to be on the 50th floor. You're going to be looking down on them. And the higher you rise, the more they're going to hate you. Good, good. You rub their noses in it. You make them suffer. Because you don't matter all that much to them. So what? So what? Screw them. Remember, the winner takes it all."
In his travels, Mal d'Or passes through the Faroe Islands off the coast of Norway and comes across a hard-working gravedigger. Mal d'Or pleads with the gravedigger to explain why he is so diligent. When Saul Goodman first meets Walt and refuses his bribe, Walt and Jesse respond by kidnapping Saul and menacing him with an open grave. Saul pleads with Walt and Jesse to explain themselves. Mal d'Or may be the ultimate source of the idea to present Saul with an open grave. René Magritte did illustrations for a 1948 edition of Les Chants de Mal d'Or. One illustration is for a story about a hermaphrodite splitting in two while unsuccessfully trying to console different people. In the episode JMM, Jimmy makes a two-faced appearance as he eyes the grieving family of the man murdered by his client Lalo. Like the hermaphrodite, Jimmy wants to console them as well as capably represent his client Lalo, but he can't do both. In his book, L'Outremont describes a man as being as handsome as the chance juxtaposition of a sewing machine and an umbrella on a dissecting table. Chance juxtapositions became a principal method of the surrealists, and L'Outremont's statement became their defining slogan. It's astonishing that Better Call Saul was able to work this slogan into the show. On the left here, we see Nacho at work in the upholstery shop. We see the sewing machine, and we see two broad-brimmed umbrella-like lights of the sort usually associated with Los Pollos Hermanos and its facilities. And Nacho dissects his hand on the dissecting table too. The Surrealists interpreted the umbrella as a masculine symbol. Interpreting broad-brimmed or broad-brimmed lights or umbrellas as masculine symbols helps explain very brief appearances in both TV shows. On the left is the Narco Corrido scene that opens Breaking Bad episode Negro y Azul. We see a man carrying an unexpected umbrella on a sunny day. And on the right, as Marco awaits the arrival of Jimmy McGill and their Rolex mark, we see a broad-brimmed interior light unexpectedly present in the exterior environment of the alley. The works of Italian artist Giorgio di Chirico often served as models for many of the early Surrealists. Di Chirico did a number of Italian plaza paintings featuring similar elements, two colonnades of arches framing a plaza with a large building or smokestacks in the background. It may be that this view of the Algodones power plant, where Price makes his drug deals with Nacho, is influenced by Di Chirico's Italian plaza scenes. Here is Di Chirico's work, The Anxious Journey, and on the right, the colonnade of arches at the church where Mike and Stacy attend their self-help group. In this particular phone call, Mike informs Price that he will assist him with the sale of empty drug capsules to Nacho, putting into motion the plot to kill Hector Salamanca. An anxious journey indeed. Di Chirico painted The House in the House, almost like a dollhouse in the house. Similarly, Walt and company place tents within the houses they fumigate. Jesse gives a plausible reason for using the tents to avoid fumigating draperies, but I suspect Di Chirico's inspiration is the real reason. Here's a 1945 work by the Czech artist Toyin called The Safes, with bloody patches at each of the open safe doors. Blood money can be found in the room of safe deposit boxes at Craddock Marine Bank in the Breaking Bad episode Say My Name. Toyin's The Safes may also be the model for HHM's Doc Review, where documents are carefully logged and the blood of corporate combat is more metaphorical. In Breaking Bad's episode 737, Skyler puts a green tea mud mask on her face. 3 weeks before harvesting, green tea destined for mud masks is placed in the dark. Chlorophyll rushes into the shaded leaves to green them up. Using the green tea mud mask is a very clever way to say that Skyler is in the dark about Walt's covert activities. And where did that clever idea come from? Here is Leonora Carrington's painting Green Tea. The painting is based on a dream she had while locked in a Spanish madhouse. Stewing in a maelstrom of bad news and no news, Carrington had lost her mind at the outset of World War II. Carrington paints herself as being in a straitjacket, and her two avatars, the hyena and the horse, are also tied up. Similar to Carrington at the outset of World War II, Skyler was stewing in a maelstrom of bad news and no news early in season 2 of Breaking Bad. Here is Max Ernst's 1920 collage, The Hat Makes the Man, which he made a century ago from sales catalog clippings. This work may have suggested to the showrunners that Heisenberg should have a trademark hat. René Magritte's The Great Century, with its gridded ceiling, may be the model upon which so many upward-looking points of view are based, such as this view of the ceiling of the courtroom where Chuck loses his cool in the episode Chicanery. Yves Tanguy made this cryptic painting with the provocative title, He Did What He Wanted. Jimmy McGill does what he wants when he defines Mrs. Nguyen when she says cucumber water for customer only. I believe this mysterious crystal in the painting is the connection between the painting and the television scene. The tabletop of the crystal, right here, has seven sides, as do the cucumber slices in the water. On the left is Remedios Varo's painting, The Farewell. There's something deeply unsettling about the man and woman in the picture departing from each other at a 90-degree angle in this de Chirico-inspired space. Despite the difference in architecture, the disturbing 90-degree angle is also present in Walt's Farewell to Elliot and Gretchen in Breaking Bad's episode Felina. On the left is Juan Miró's Ladders Cross a Blue Sky in a Wheel of Fire. Miró's works often include these filament-like ladders that are being carried across the sky by the moon, the stars, and the planets. Miró considered the ladders to be avenues of escape from Earth into heaven. In the episode Lantern, as Chuck McGill begins to unravel, he climbs a ladder to start removing lights and electrical gadgets from his home. In the following episode Smoke, as Jimmy runs up to the ruins of Chuck's house, we see the firemen putting away their ladder on their truck. That film segment is immediately repeated in order to drive home the point that Chuck has indeed escaped to heaven. And in conclusion, here on the left is Paul Klee's Introduction of the Miracle. In 1916, like so many others, Klee was a soldier on the front lines of the Great War, but strings were pulled and he was sent to do aircraft maintenance instead, and to paint in his spare time. Right here, near the center of the painting, and blown up here in the middle, is what appears to be Walter White from the pilot episode of Breaking Bad, green shirt, bare legs, and everything. Walt looks pretty sassy. His hand appears to be pointed at the viewer. It would be interesting to learn the full story of how Walt started from this fantastical canvas and ended up in distress in the New Mexico desert 91 years later. And so with that, thank you very much for your attention.